and welcome back to The Enchanted Self. I'm Dr. Barbara Becker Holstein of The Enchanted Self, psychologist and author, and I'm so delighted to be back with you. Here I am in my enchanted land. I just got back from a walk out in the fields looking in the sunshine, the grasses, and everything was so beautiful. I'm so happy it's spring again. And I was thinking about some of the things that I teach to you and how for all of us, walking through the seven gateways of enchantment is so, so important. How we have to take our time and have the confidence to walk through the first gateway, which is getting to know our own talents again and our lost potential, seeing that we're so unique and we have gifts. And my gifts are different than your gifts, so there's plenty of gifts to go around. And then going through the second gateway to enchantment and recognizing that not only do I have gifts, but the story of my life is so special, and I have to honor it and bring it forth and be willing to tell it and live it. And then the third gateway, learning to meet our needs and negotiate. Go for that education we forgot to do or didn't want to bother at the time. It's tough, it's work, but it's worth it. And then the next gateway to enchantment, so important for women, replenishment, not running on empty. Fill yourself up again with joy, using your imagination and your hopes and dreams and your creativity. And then we need to go through the gate of mentoring and being mentored and realizing our wisdom. We have so much to offer, so many wise things to share. Let's do it. And then the next gateway, belonging, not isolating, not staying alone and in the dark, but going for the light and being with other people. And lastly, and this is so important, acts of kindness, the gateway of positive action. Well, this gateway, wow, I'm just thinking, this gateway kind of takes me to where my head has been. Because I've been drifting in and out as I've gone through my walks, through remembering something very special, that as much as it's so important, all the things that I teach, there is something even greater than that, tied into miracles and just the divine intervening in ways that neither you nor I could really plan. You see this little book? I'm trying to get it so you can see it. It's a book on miracle stories, and it's written by Mary Ellen, who's one of my great friends, who's done just the collection of hundreds and hundreds of miracle stories. Well, I was thinking about her, and I was thinking, here I am alone in this gorgeous enchanted land. I'm happy. I feel good. The sun is shining. But I would love to have a friend so we could share some of our miracle stories. Would it be too much and too beyond the enchanted self to wish that Mary Ellen could come into my enchanted land? Oh, come on, that's just so ridiculous, Barbara. Even you, as an enchanted self lady, shouldn't go that far. No, no, wait, wait. It may not be beyond. I can wish for it. I can wish for it. Wait a minute, wait a minute. Oh my, I see in the distance that she's coming very, very, very quickly. Wow! Mary Ellen!
Hello, Barbara.
Hi!
I thought I'd just fly into your enchanted
I can't believe it. It worked, didn't it?
Pretty good, because I came all the way from Oregon just to meet you and your guests.
I'm so delighted. Do you remember? You must remember your first book, Expect Miracles.
Expect Miracles is my very first book, and how it came about is a series of miracles.
Oh, tell me. Tell us.
I truly believe in acts of kindness create miracles for other people. And what happened is I was living in Gig Harbor, Washington at the time, and my husband had three jobs. He had one job, but they gave him three positions. And what ended up happening was I was very lonesome and very isolated, everything that you had just talked about. And I had all this love in my heart and decided to share it. Now, miracles happen to me all the time. So what I did was started to share them with people on the internet. And as I shared them, they would send me their miracles. And Barbara, I ended up in a 6-week period with 1,000 people on
Wow.
a mailing list. And then there was an email, and it came from somebody asking to be on their charity website. Well, you'd never guess who was on the charity website. It was Prince, the musician's webmaster. And they put me on their website for 3 years. And then a week later, I received another email asking if they could post my good news stories onto their website. And now these are free emails that I'm sending out around the world. And it's just taken on a life of its own. I'm a housewife, you know, in a very isolated place, but I wanted to give back to the world. And before I knew it, I had 1,000 people on the newsletter mail list, and then it's grown now, and approximately 50,000 people around the world are reading it. And I polled them, and I know they've come from 50 countries, and some of them I don't even know about it. And then, a year later, I complained I had so many miracles, you know, acts of kindness and miracles are everywhere, that I mentioned in the newsletter, and my phone rang 15 minutes later. The editor of Canary Press, who put out this book, asked if I would do a book. And a year later, they called, and may I show this one? This
sure.
one matches my dress.
Oh, it does.
This is a Christmas filled with miracles. And for a housewife with no aspirations, and I know people out there have tried to get their books done, how difficult it is to find a publisher. But when you live in the land of enchantment and miracles, and you pray to whatever your belief is, just know that they can happen.
Wow, this is an incredible story.
Thank you.
And you were ahead of the curve on the internet, because I know I found you 7 or 8 years ago.
That's correct.
That's right.
And what an honor it is, a person in your position with your gifts, to enjoy my newsletters. And could you tell the readers why, or the listeners? I'm used to readers.
Yes.
Could you tell them why you
enjoyed
it so
much? Well,
I love
the way Mary Ellen writes her newsletters. They're very simple. They're very, very, very authentic. They're from the heart. And they just tell a simple miracle that has recently happened to someone. Mm-hmm. For example, I'll let Mary Ellen tell a story, but for example, if I had written in when I needed surgery, but I didn't know I needed surgery, and 3 weeks before the surgery, we had just opened the pocket doors in my house between the living room and the dining room and the hallway, so that when I needed surgery, and I had to be home a couple of months, I didn't have to entirely stop seeing my clients. We closed off the pocket doors, which were heavy as lead and very soundproof, and I was able to have some of my clients come and see me for psychological help till I was well again. So if I had written that in, mm-hmm. you would have set it up in a very simple fashion, and
exactly.
It's so easy to read, it's loving. You have some beautiful quotes, very
Thank
inspirational
you.
Quotes.
Thank you.
But you tell a couple of your favorites.
Well, I want to share my latest miracle. And just like Barbara's, they don't have to be huge. You don't have to be hanging off a cliff in your car. And this particular miracle was, I was in Tacoma, Washington. It's a 6-hour drive north of my home. And it was with a friend who loves to garage shop. So we were going around from home to home. And the very first one we stopped off, they had this great big bag of socks. And it said free on it. And I looked into the bag, and I said to the homeowner, did you know that the missions, the homeless shelters, love to receive socks? Because most husbands, spouses, men, they wear their socks out. Barbara, they don't, they just chuck them out. They don't donate them. And so socks is a prized commodity to people that are out on the street and on their feet all day, and especially in our area where it rains. And so what happened is every garage sale after that, and we even drove for about 1.5 hours away from Sid's home, we found socks after socks after socks, and we kept saying, well, we're going to the mission, would you like us to take the socks? And they all said yes. Well, we ended up with 20 pounds of socks. We could hardly move in the cab of the truck. And so we went down to the homeless shelter, and we carried these out, and we plunked them on the counter, and the lady said, what do you have there? And I said one word, and it totally changed her. She scared me. I said, socks. And she goes, like this, and jumps back. And I thought, what's wrong with socks? And she says, I can't believe this. She said, our bin's been empty for 2 weeks.
Wow.
and we have no socks. And then she turned and pointed to one more box and said, see that box over there? That is a box of brand new socks that came in 15 minutes ago. So I call that the sock it to me miracle. And it didn't cost me any money or any time,
right,
but
right.
we became the answer to other people's prayers.
That's a beautiful story. And I think for everyone, miracles come in different ways. For example, the type of work that I'm doing, very often, I don't get a turnaround response. Yes, in my treatment room I do, but when I send out on the internet, and I have about 3,000 subscribers and still building, I don't know where it's going, you know, unless the person answers me.
That's right.
And so a couple of weeks ago when I got an answer from a lady in South Africa who said she had had some real sadness and felt pretty low about herself, and that my newsletter was cheering her up to the point where she had the courage to go back for mental health care that she needed. So it wasn't like a joyous story like, oh, I'm so happy. It was a breakthrough, realizing what she needed to do, but
that's
the
beautiful.
Inspiration had come. And so that really was a mini miracle.
That was a major miracle. I've had 4 people on my mailing list that have said that their lives have been saved. They felt suicidal, but they learned that there was good, there was kind people in the world, and they learned that they were good and kind, and that they liked to lift a cornflake box or the oats down off a high shelter for an elderly person. Now they're going out of their way to help people, and they said they're a better person from it. And these letters come, like you, from South Africa, from India, from England, and people said their perspective has changed. I don't say that miracles come from one belief, but people all around the world have miracles. I just want to share a little miracle that happened to me. It's the one that put me on my path. What happened was I was newly married. My husband and I were going for our honeymoon. It was several months after we were married, actually. And I had 2 silver Persian cats, Camelot and Chanel, and we took them along with us. You know, Barbara, they're not the best in the car. And we had them on leashes, and we got to Lake Chelan, which is a very tiny town in Washington with a lake. And that had been our destiny. And we put the cats out on the leashes, and 15 minutes later, we looked around, and Camelot, well, this is 25 years ago. I'd spent $300 on that cat, but he was worth $1 million to my heart. I loved him so much, and he was gone. He'd been raised in a cage. He had no survival skills. And I started looking all around town, and everybody said, oh, he'll be up a tree somewhere, he's scared. I said, no, this cat will be so scared, he'll be underneath a bush or somewhere small. So I concentrated on that. I went to the newspaper, I went to the 2 schools in the area, and I let everybody know about Camelot missing, till the whole town knew. It had about 2,000 people in it. We never did swim in the lake, and even at night, I go around calling for him, and I go, liver, liver, because that's what he came to, was his favorite food, but he didn't come. So this is when I was believing that there was a higher power out there, but I was a skeptic believer. And so I finally said at 4 o'clock in the morning when we had to return home to Canada the next day, I said, dear God, if you're out there, if you're really, really out there, please, please lead me to Camelot. And then I stood perfectly still, and then I did a slow rotational turn. And as I turned partway, I felt these invisible hands being placed on the back of my shoulders, and they pushed me, and I started to move at the same speed you would if you're going to catch a bus. And they pushed me to the left, and then at the end of that block, they pushed me to the right. They would change their pressure on my shoulders. The next block to the left, and then to the next block partway up the hill, and then the sun came up, and the hands evaporated like the land of enchantment had ended. And I thought, well, I wonder what that was all about. And then this great grief came over me because morning was there and we had to head home to Canada back to our jobs. And I stopped for a minute and I called Camelot's name and I heard this little meow.
Aww.
And he was between me and he was underneath the next bush. He wasn't even 20 feet from me. And I had been led, and that's when I realized there is a higher power, and even if you can't see it or touch it,
was he hurt
it's there.
Or anything?
He was really, he was very thin, he hadn't eaten, and Lake Chelan is a very hot area, And so we took him back to the camper, and when I released him and put him into the camper, the whole time we left the back door of the camper open in case he came home, and Chanel walked right up to him, took her little paw, and hit him on the face.
You should know better.
Yes, like you caused an awful lot of trouble. And then as we drove out of the campsite, we mentioned to the gatekeeper, she was a 21-year-old female, that we had just found our cat. Now the whole town was looking for us. And she started to cry, and she said today was her 21st birthday, and she said that was the best present to know that.
Wow.
And you know what? Miracles are often surrounded around love.
You know, there's so many different types of miracles. You're making me think in different directions. I'm thinking about a miracle that happened to me with that same type of push. I was involved, I had written part of my first book, The Enchanted Self, A Positive Therapy, and like most people in the publishing world, I was just going crazy. I didn't know what to do with it. I didn't know how to form it. I didn't know who would want it. And I had gone to a national women's conference, and I was presenting, but I still didn't know what would happen. I was in this giant room with all these presses around me and stuff, and I literally felt like I was pushed to go to a particular table. I almost tripped, you know, getting across the room to that table. And at that table was Kathleen O'Malley, who was at that time an editor with Gordon and Breach Science Publishers. My first book came out as an academic book. And she, you know, it's like I was led to her. She came to my workshop, and that was the beginning of the publication.
And that's what we need to pay attention to, the little signs, literally God nudging you. I mean, if God came up right behind you, or spirit, or goddess, whatever people believe in, and had a great big booming voice said, Barbara, turn right. You'd have jumped out of your socks and ran out of the building. But it's the little feelings in your stomach that you feel, and what somebody will say to you. Say you're at a bus stop, and you turn to somebody and say, did you know such and such? And they go, oh, I was just praying for an answer to that. Mm-hmm. And that's how spirit leads you to people through miracles.
Right.
They pray,
right.
And you are often the hands or the feet or the voice to help that miracle take place.
I think another type of miracle is simply doing your work and not getting stuck in paralysis. And that if you do your work, then whatever needs to happen can come through. You know, if you don't do your work, it interrupts a lot of the flow.
Well, there is a story in Expect Miracles, which is, it's more than the name of a really good book. It's a way of life for some people. But Judy, who lives in New Jersey, she was the head of our Angels and Miracles prayer team, which people can find by going to the website. And it is an Angels and Miracles prayer team. What she wrote one day was an email, and it said, after I read your Angels and Miracles stories, my spirit grows so big, it doesn't feel like my skin can hold it in anymore. And I thought, what beautiful words, and what a kind person this person must be. And at that point, because I was having so many personal miracles, everybody thought I was like plugged into God, and they were asking me to pray for them. Well, I had so many prayer requests, plus I had the newsletter stories to do, that I asked Judy if she would like to head the miracle prayer team. And she said yes. And shortly after that, she said that she had done one of the exercises in the newsletter that said, if you would like to be a miracle worker, ask God to be a divine vehicle for his energy to move through you so that you can become the hands and feet. And she thought, that sounded good. She liked to try that. It wasn't 15 minutes later, there was a knock at her front door, and she went running over to it. And when she opened her apartment door, her best friend, Ruth, fell into her arms with a heart attack.
Oh, wow.
And Judy's husband, Dan, called 911, and they took care of Ruth. They got her to the hospital. Then they took care of Ruth's elderly husband for several days. And when it was all home and Ruth came home by the end of the week and made Judy a very nice hot apple pie, Dan said to Judy, now, don't pray for a miracle every day, he said, because the last time it wore me out. So, and
yes,
I wanted to just mention, too, that I'm being hosted here in your beautiful city by Carol Joe, who's also on the prayer team. The prayer team has grown, and now there's 250 prayer team members from all beliefs all around the world. And, you know, I think that's how God would really work.
Oh, yes, that sounds so wonderful. So what's happening for you? What do you envision, and what are some of your dreams for the next, you know, period in your life, 5 years, 10 years?
Oh, I would so love to take my work a step further from doing it on the internet the way I am, and to have a miracle segment on a radio show or a TV show where I can reach people who don't have access to the internet. Could you imagine standing around the water cooler at work, and in the morning, when we're younger, we'd all tell the Ann Landers stories, or we talk about what's in the news, and people are sad. They don't want to keep hearing the sad part mm-hmm. of the news. Mm-hmm. And if they had a miracle, they could share it with each other, and this would give people hope and inspiration, and I want to be a vehicle to do that, to brighten their lives.
That's very, very good. It seems like you're push for what you want to do is so, so similar to the push that I want to do.
Yes.
You know, I feel like the energies are just, they're almost identical. It's just perhaps the training and where we ended up in life and what we do on a daily basis mm-hmm. is a little bit different. But that push, and I have found for women, well, you have tremendous energy now, but for me, working with women in the treatment room and helping women all the time, this is a very serious problem, that women will have their dreams, they have their hopes, they have their energies, but then they get criticized. I always remember the woman whose husband said, well, that and a dime will get you a cup of coffee, you know, and it was critically damaging to her.
Yes.
Yes, don't laugh. There's a male laughing somewhere in the background. But it hurt. And what I have found is that as women, and this is one of the major reasons I started The Enchanted Self, let's label ourselves as enchanted selves, that we know how to grasp onto the joys in life, the energy that we need to give to life. We're willing to work very hard. We enjoy the pleasure and the hard work. We know what we're doing, we have goals, we have purpose, and we don't have to dismiss and diminish what feels good or feels right. We can listen to those subtle cues. And in honor of all of that, not only have my books been pouring forth, my latest one being There Comes a Time in Every Woman's Life for Delight. Yes, delight, pleasure, of all sorts, spiritual, emotional, good health, everything. But I have also a special little treat that Mary Ellen doesn't know about yet, and that is I have my Enchanted Self necklaces, which are the cornerstone of my efforts to help find something for women that they can wear, you know, that makes them always conscious mm-hmm. that they are an Enchanted Self person. So I worked with an artist on this heart. Of course, we know the heart for a woman,
right.
The spiral of energy, the endless spiral. And then we played with different colors and chords and so on. But I now, you're my guest and our time is coming quickly to an end. I'm now taking off my own necklace and giving it to you.
Thank you.
So you're going to go home. You are truly an enchanted self, lady.
I feel so honored.
I hope you really enjoy it.
Thank you.
So, and now the last couple of minutes are for you. So if you wanted to quickly tell another miracle story or whatever you would like.
Oh, gosh, there's so many miracles.
Yes. Yes.
Let me see. Well, can I tell a Christmas miracle
sure,
tree story?
Sure.
What happened one Christmas was, it was right after I had married my husband, and we lived on Vancouver Island, and we put our two silver Persians in the car, and we were going across to Vancouver to spend it with my mother. And my mother's husband had just been diagnosed with terminal cancer, and it was very sad days. And so we arrive in the pouring rain, which it always does in Vancouver, British Columbia, in the dark of night. And when we entered my mother's house, it wasn't the house of the childhood that I remembered. It was silent. And all of Jim's medications were lined up like soldiers against his war of cancer. And we went in, and we all went to bed early. Nobody wanted to stay up late and talk. And when we woke up on Christmas morning, it didn't just feel like the Christmas I'd remembered in that house. My mom had been there for 23 years. And so I thought, well, I'm going to phone my girlfriend back on Vancouver Island and see how she's doing. So, you know, as a girlfriend, you have her number memorized. And I dialed it up, and when she answered, I heard, "Hello?" And I thought, "Now what could be wrong?" And I said, "Are you okay?" And she said, "Who is this?" I went, "Oh no, this isn't my girlfriend. I woke a total stranger up on Christmas morning." And then, because I like to talk and nobody else was up in the house, I said to Faith, "You know, what are you doing?" And she said, "Well, my husband's dead and I don't have anywhere to go." Mm. And I thought, "Oh no, her Christmas morning's worse than ours, because at least we had each other." And so I invited her to come over to my mother's house for Christmas dinner after asking my mother, because I talked to her for 45 minutes. And she called the bus, and she rode the bus in the snow on Christmas morning when there weren't too many people on the bus. And she's in her 80s, and she's a widow. And wow. She arrived, and we had the best Christmas ever. And as she was leaving, she said that... my mother said, "Oh, my mom's very British proper." And she said, "What is your name?" And Faith says, "It's Holden." My mom says, no, that's my name. We had the same last name, as if we invited family to dinner.
Oh, that's a great story.
Thank
Mary
you.
Ellen.
From a wrong phone number.
Oh, all right. I see that we're getting that signal even into the Enchanted Kingdom that our time is running out. So we're going to leave for now the Enchanted Forest and the Enchanted Self. Thank you, Mary Ellen,
for coming in
right on cue. That was wonderful.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure, and I hope to see you so often.
I'll fly back.
Yes. Bye for now. Bye to everybody out there. Have a good one.